Julia Gordon-Bramer is a poet. She is a scholar, an author, a professional tarot card reader who spent the last decade interpreting Sylvia Path's work through mysticism. Her newest book is Tarot Life Lessons. Welcome back to the show, Julia.
Hi, thank you, George. It's great to see you again.
Yeah, excited to have you back on. Refresh our memory, even though this is our fifth time. Tell us a little about your personal life, some more about your work, and why you do what you do.
Yeah, I didn't realize it was my fifth time. I'm so honored. So who am I? I am a professional tarot card reader, as you said, a scholar of Sylvia Plath and her mysticism, and an author. And I'm really excited about my new book, Tarot Life Lessons. And this came out of COVID when my husband suggested he'd been saying for a long time that I had some really good stories. And during COVID, during the quarantine, I thought, I'm going to go through my journals. And I just started looking. I journal regularly. And so some of the more memorable ones, some of those stories that changed my life or just were so impactful in one way or another, I had recorded for myself originally. And because I'm a creative writer, I had fun with it. You know, I put a little flair into it and dialogue and all of that. And so during COVID, I just went through my journals and started stacking them up and thought, I have a book here. And what I did was I attached a story to each of the major arcana tarot cards, starting with the Fool card, which is number 0, which is my own story, because everyone always asks me, how did you become a tarot card reader? How do you learn? You know, how do you know if you're a psychic? Things like that. And so I put all of that into my first story. And then we go into all the client stories. And that's where the good stuff is, because that's when we've got scam artists and we've got gold diggers and we have a murderer and we have, you know, people who are terminally lonely and we have kids who are self-inflicting harm on themselves. I mean, everything, you know, it just runs the gamut. And I like to say that these are life lessons, and that each tarot card has a lot of meat, that a lot of wisdom, you know, that I can offer my clients on healing their stuff and helping them out of the hard times. So it was really fun to put together. Because I think it was a God thing. It got snatched up right away for publication by Destiny Books, which is a subsidiary of Inner Traditions. And wow, what a great team over there. Just got to give props to them. And they also have picked up another book of mine coming out next year, which is The Occult Sylvia Plath. And I'm also very excited about that. But maybe we'll talk about that one next year.
Perfect.
Yeah.
So practical uses, and what is the right term, if there is a right term? I'm experiencing a problem. You referenced a young person who was experiencing some trouble. How does tarot play into that?
Well, you know, I think tarot, in a very visual way, because of course I'm reading for the client and they can see the cards if they're with me. And I do readings online. And so, you know, through video, like we could do a Zoom and I could hold up a card as well. So, you know, if I were reading for you, you could see the card and share that experience. When the picture is right in front of you, it can move you on a very deeply personal level. So if I'm in that story that I mentioned, there was a teenage girl cutting herself, and it became really apparent fast what was going on. And her cards, of course, are full of swords, you know, these knives, and really kind of gory, sort of bloody images. And it had to be that clear to get to the heart of her problem, if that makes sense. She had to be able to see that I could see what was going on. And so it was sort of all spelled out there. A lot of the guidance that I give through the cards comes from, you know, my what I call cafeteria plan of spirituality. I grew up in the Episcopal Church, and I have a very Christian background, but not traditionally so. And I am a student of Buddhism and the Tao, and I am a teacher of A Course in Miracles. And so, you know, all of this sort of feeds into my tarot, and I can look at the cards and I can see lessons coming from some of the scriptures and teachings that I know. And I usually share that with my clients. So I'm not a traditional tarot card reader in the way that you're probably not going to find my answers always in the tarot books on, you know, what such and such a card means. I'm doing a lot of it off of intuition, and I'm using the pictures for cues, and it's a very mutual reading experience, because of course I don't know my clients' lives or what's going on in their subconscious in a conscious fashion. I'm just mirroring what I see to them, and they're interpreting it with me. So they're seeing in this deck, you know, as I hold up the cards. Yeah, I'm sorry, is that my computer making that noise or?
All good.
Anyway, but yeah. So I don't know if that answered.
is this a fair sort of analogy? If I were a non-Christian or a non-Jew, and I picked up the Bible and I just started reading it, it sort of makes sense to me. But without knowing the deeper meanings of it, would it be similar if I just picked up a deck of tarot cards and started looking at them? I could sort of kind of infer, but I wouldn't get it.
Well, so I have another story in the book of a guy at a party who's quite drunk, who knows nothing about tarot, who takes my deck and says, well, let me read those cards for you, you know, and he throws them down on the table and he starts to, you know, and he's just riffing off the pictures, but he did a surprisingly good reading for me. And I believe it was, first of all, because he was open, you know, because when you're drunk, he's not worried about being wrong.
Sure.
You know, he's not afraid of making a fool of himself. He's already, you know, he's already gone. So he was just taking the cues. And honestly, this is very intuitive. And so I think everyone is intuitive to different degrees, and it's just teaching yourself to trust that and to kind of follow down the rabbit hole where that goes. But not everybody can do it. A lot of people are kind of wound a little too tight and, you know, are just afraid of guessing wrong or being made a fool of themselves in some way. But I do think anyone can read the cards.
So in the example of the young woman, does it prescribe a course of action moving forward? What is, for lack of a better term, the point?
Yeah. In my case, I gave her very clear, specific directions that this had to stop and, you know, or else, and kind of how bad it could get. And I think she was pretty shaken up, and because I didn't follow up, you know, because it's not my place. Sometimes I really wish I could follow up and know that people are going to end up all right. But sometimes my job is just to plant the seed and hope they take it, you know, hope it grows. Obviously, everybody has a complicated life, and you don't get to a point where you're hurting yourself without a lot of pain in your background. But sometimes all it takes, and I know this from my own experience growing up as a teenager, sometimes it's just one person that can see you and can recognize and say something. And so I feel like I've been blessed that maybe that person's been me a time or two through the tarot.
I appreciate that. So we have these oral traditions that have been passed down for thousands and thousands of years before we had, you know, written word and everything else. How long has tarot been around? Maybe not in its exact form.
Yeah. Well, we know that the first tarot cards showed up in Italy in the 1400s. And they were different. It was sort of a fancy card game for the wealthy royals and, you know, in the elite. However, there's a lot of lore built into that. And the story goes that the Romani, I know it's not a politically correct term anymore, but the gypsies encoded meanings within these cards. And they did this to basically smuggle across Europe their secrets of alchemy and mysticism and all of the religious ideas that were not necessarily approved of in the days of the Crusades, when you could die if you weren't Catholic. Tarot is in line with the Kabbalah Tree of Life, which is Jewish mysticism, which of course was not popular during the Crusades. And you know, you couldn't be a Jew. And so there's a lot of kind of lore and baggage, and how much of it is actually true is very difficult to prove. But we do know that today's cards, when I say today's, within the last couple hundred years, based on the Rider-Waite system, which happened around the turn of the century with the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, and they purposefully encoded numerology and mythology and religion and history and alchemy and all astrology, astronomy. It's all sort of built into the tarot card designs. And so that's why there's so much meaning in one given tarot card, and that it can say so much for a person.
It's very cool. The story about the gypsies using the cards or physical thing to sort of sneak their culture and their traditions. I think that's incredible. The idea, we live in such a strange time where we've got misinformation and malinformation and fake news and this, that, and the other thing. You said truth. And I wrote down truth and wisdom. Whether something is true or not, is that separate from wisdom? Because it strikes me that something that's been done since the 14th century carries a ton of wisdom with it.
Sure. I mean, there are, well, look at ancient Greece. I mean, the mythology that comes from ancient Greece, all of our psychiatric terms are named after that stuff, because they had this wisdom about our neuroses and our complexes, and you know, that they aligned with their gods, and to explain so much, and it still is absolutely relevant. Man has not changed that much in thousands of years, given, you know, all the technology and stuff. The essence of us is, we're still the same. We still have the same needs and the same desires. We may do it differently. We still have the same addictions and weaknesses. Yeah. But so, you know, truth in these days, gosh, what is truth? You know, I mean, that's such a, it's been the question of the philosophers for forever. Today, I think all we've got is really just that deep knowing if something feels right or not, if something feels loving and kind and correct, or you know, deceitful or angry, or, you know, some of the other motivations.
Isn't that the truth? And so much of our, I was going to say modern living, but in 100 years, we're going to use the term modern living, and then it's going to be modern living right. 100 years. So the current state of affairs is, what is it that we can just solve things through technology and innovation? And maybe we can, but we all know we have that deep knowing, which is inside. Is that inside all of us?
I believe it is. You know, I think technology and innovation can do a lot, but we're all really becoming very aware that we're losing our humanity in the pursuit of it. And that we've got a whole generation now that doesn't know how to look people in the eye and shake hands and have basic social courtesies, you know, and feel, you know, that term awkward. People are embracing it. They're embracing the term autistic, for God's sakes. And I see it all the time. Like, they are afraid to mix with others and afraid of connection. And if tarot does anything, it connects, and it connects me to the person I'm reading for, because I can see them on a deeper level and I can reflect the truth of them and where their energy is going and what their belief system is. And I can bring it to their consciousness in a way that's clear. Yeah, you know, I think that it's all about connection, and I do think we're losing that a lot. And so maybe tarot is going to be one of the tools to get it back. I can only hope.
Yeah, well, certainly anything that helps foster that interpersonal exchange. There's so much value in simply talking about things. And these days we have so few, at least it strikes me that, let me take a big step back. One of the things I enjoy so much about doing the podcast is I get the opportunity to spend 20 minutes with somebody where we're giving each other our 100% undivided attention. And it's so rare. So I can see exactly what you're saying, how tarot gives you that opportunity just through a different medium, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess that's all.
So it's a clunky, crude way to kind of ask or say it, but what is, if you could just make the case for why I should, or what I stand to gain from having a tarot reading?
Well, it will show you in a very clear way where your energy is going. You can ask me, you could say, give me a general reading and just see what shows up for me. And a lot of times, you know, for a young man your age, I'd probably see career stuff and family stuff and, you know, kind of the most important things in your life, right? Sometimes people want very specific direction, and they can say, you know, I've got this work project and I want to see where you see this thing specifically going, or I'm having this relationship conflict and, you know, I'm estranged from my brother, or my kid is just not cooperating in any way. And we can get into that kind of relationship and where the loved one's head is and what people are feeling and what they understand about the situation. And that can just bring some clarity, really, and sometimes some tools, you know, some actual advice. People will say, well, I don't know what to do about this. Can you tell me? And I'll see what the cards say. And, you know, the interesting thing about the cards is it's almost always about going in. You know, Gandhi said, be the change you wish to see in the world. And I always say, he didn't mean be a model citizen. He said, if you see war out there, you have to, and obviously we got a lot of that going on right now, right? You have to look inside and say, where's the war in me right now? You know, do I have a war with my sister going on right now? Do I have a war with my job? Do I, am I in this turmoil? Am I not willing to have some debate or to put myself on the other side's, you know, point of view and really, you know, find that place of peace and love? We have to bring it in always. And that helps give us personal peace. And when we make that change in ourselves, it does our part to change the world.
I love that. I love the idea of interrogating reality. And if I understand,
that's a cool term, interrogating reality.
It's from the book Fierce Conversations. Awesome term. And am I hearing you correctly that you mentioned a minute ago that it's telling us where our energy is going, but it's not telling me what I want to hear or what I think I should hear. It's telling me what is. And based on what is, I can accept that information and say, wow, okay. it sounds like I need to make these changes or adjustments or consider these things if I'm not happy with what is.
Right. Because it's a heads up. Because, you know, like, so I always tell my clients, I can read your cards because we're connected just by being alive. I call that life force God. I don't tell people how to do God, what to call God. That's totally your business. You know, if you want to call it source, if you want to call it the universe, energy, Allah, Buddha, whatever, you know, it's all on you. But if you can say, all right, I'm alive, I'm hooked into this God system, and you therefore have great power over your life. You know, we know in so many other ways that our minds are powerful. You know, athletes, they know to keep their eyes on the prize, that they don't say, what if I trip and fall? What if I don't make it to the finish line? Because that opens up that space for that negative thing to happen. Doctors know about the power of the mind with the placebo effect and with the will to live. So these are universal principles. We just forget when we're looking at, you know, our love life or our relationships with our families, and what we put our mind on grows. And so I show you where to put your mind and where it's working and where it's not working. And we all have our little negative things that we focus on now and then. Everybody does it. But worry doesn't serve us. You know, it's not helpful.
No, it's not. I love it. You summed up my ramblings beautifully by saying it's a heads up. So it's awesome. Well, Julia, thank you so much for coming back on. Where can people learn more about you? Where can they engage, or where can they get their copy of Tarot Life Lessons?
Awesome. Well, they can find me. My website is juliagordonbramer.com. Gordon, G-O-R-D-O-N, Bramer, B-R-A-M-E-R. And I'm on all the social networks. I'm on Facebook and I'm on Twitter and I'm on Instagram. You can find my book, Tarot Life Lessons, through any of the major booksellers. It's available for pre-order right now, and then November 7th is the official release date. I have also recorded an audiobook for it, which was really fun and a ton of work. And oh my gosh, I had no idea how hard it would be, but I think I did a good job. You know, you can't just read, you have to act it out, right? So it was, it required a little bit of effort from me here, but that will be released shortly after the November 7th date. I'm not sure exactly when. And then there's a release in Europe about a month after as well.
Very exciting. Well, if you enjoyed this much as I did, show Julia your appreciation and share the show with somebody else who appreciates good ideas. Go to learn more about Julia at juliagordonbramer.com. It's Julia spelled normally, G-O-R-D-O-N, which I think is also spelled normally. And then Bramer, B-R-A-M-E-R.com, and find her on social media. I'll link all those in the notes of the show. And you can pick up your copy of Tarot Life Lessons right now on pre-order. And it actually goes on sale November the 7th. And pick up your copy and dig deeper into what we've been talking about today. Thanks again, Julia.
Thank you, George. Great to see you again.
Great to
catch
see
you next year.
Indeed. And until next time, remember, do your part by doing your best.